Mina, Gunbunwah, Jesus Freaking Gamer here. 30-minute message for today, Sunday. I'm getting it almost out on time. Not exactly, but almost. It's going to be a little bit earlier than 6 o'clock Monday morning, so woo! Wait, two thumbs up. That's two thumbs. I promise there's a thumb holding up behind the Bible there that's flipping the pages. Today, I decided to cover another one of the Omni. So it's kind of like I have two series going on at once. It's kind of weird. I've got the Heaven one going on, and I've got the Omni series going on. I'll probably bounce back and forth, or who knows, maybe I'll do the Omnipresence next week. However it goes is however it goes, and it'll all be on YouTube, so you can see them in order if you want. You can mix them up if you want. You can ignore them all together if you want. Completely up to you, but it is there, and it will be available for you to see if you so desire. So today we're going to go with the omnipotence of God, and that means all powerful. To kind of set a framework for the omnipotence of God, it's kind of like, what exactly does that mean, all powerful? So let me kick this off with the traditional verses that talk about God being all powerful. The first one, where it's like, you know, with God all things are possible, that actually comes from Matthew chapter 19. I'm going to start with verse 23 and end with verse 26. This is after the rich young ruler came to Jesus and was like, you know, hey, good teacher, what do I have to do to be saved? Why do you call me good? There's only one good, who is God. By the way, hint, hint, wink, wink, I am God, so you're actually dead on. Do you even realize how right you are? You know, follow the commandments, which ones, blah, 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 blah. Law of Moses, like, I'm doing all that stuff. What am I missing? And he's like, if you want to be perfect, go sell everything you have, give it to the poor, come follow me. And the dude walks away and is like, no. So he rejected Jesus because he didn't want to give up everything. That doesn't mean necessarily that if you're rich, you need to give up everything. It's more of a question of, where is your heart? Are you going to serve God, or are you going to serve yourself, your money, this life? What's more important to you? Who's really your master? Kind of, that's another verse that I didn't look up because it doesn't have to do with the omnipotence of God, but you can only serve one master, either God or mammon. Mammon being a word essentially for, like, I think like a god of greed or a god of money. Some translations simply say God or money. That is essentially what it means, although there is a bit of an idol connotation to what Jesus said. So again, you don't have to give up everything you have and like live on the streets to serve Jesus, but you do have to be willing to give him everything. You have to surrender every part of yourself to him. You have to submit to your God. You have to submit to your master. That's what it means to be a Christian, to be saved. And this particular rich man wasn't willing to do that. So all of that is a backdrop for verse 23. If you want the full story, just go up, start at verse 16. Go up to verse 16 in this chapter, and that'll give you some backstory and some context to this verse. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Assuredly I say to you that it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven, giving up everything, because he has quite a bit in earthly manner. In earthly ways. And again I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." Quick dispelling of an old myth: there is no needle gate in Jerusalem. That is an old tale fabricated during the Dark Ages, and there is no such thing as a needle gate. It's not like you know, it's a needle gate, so you have, you know, the camel and the rider, they would just have to get on their knees to pass through as an act of piety and humility. No. Jesus is literally saying, for a camel to go through the eye of a needle, that thing you thread your thread through at the top of a needle, yeah, getting a camel through there is easier than a rich man entering the kingdom of God. Quite clearly, that is completely and totally impossible. And that was the whole point of the analogy. And the disciples, of all the times that they were dumb and didn't pick up on stuff, they picked up on this. In verse 25, when his disciples heard it, they were greatly astonished, saying, "Who then can be saved?" But Jesus looked at them and said to them, and here's the verse, "With men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." And of course, not everyone is rich, so it's like, well, does that mean only the poor can be saved? Again, no. If you are poor and you refuse to give up the little bit that you have, if you are a haughty and proud person, and you're only looking to get what you can get, different motivation than a rich person, but it's kind of like the same heart from the other end of the boat, that poor person also cannot be saved. And so the disciples hear this and they're just like, well, who can be saved? You know, this is kind of impossible. And Jesus is like, no, with God it's possible. God can do the impossible. So that, I feel like that's a very popularly quoted verse, and I thought it would be amiss if I didn't use that verse here in this particular message. It's not so much referring to an all-powerful God as it's referring to an all-saving God. Now, is God all-powerful? I do believe so, and I believe the scripture says as much. But this verse doesn't seem to, like, talk about, you know, this all-powerful, you know, God who can kick anyone's butt and create absolutely anything and do all sorts of cool tricks and, you know, just do mind-bending, you know, reality-warping things. It doesn't really speak to that. What it basically says is human beings can't save themselves. It's impossible. But God, with God, it is possible for Him to find a way to save sinners. And of course, as always, I'll get to that at the end of this 30-minute message. So there is that verse there. Another very popular verse in regards to this is going to be Philippians 4:13. As soon as I say it, as soon as I quote it, some of y'all already know exactly what I'm talking about. As soon as I quote it, you're going to know it, because if you've ever been to church, you've ever been around a Bible or a Bible thumper, you've probably heard this verse. It's incredibly popular and quite understandably so. Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You've almost definitely heard that verse. 99% of the time you've been around the Bible long enough, church long enough, Christian long enough, you've heard that verse. And of course, Christ is God. Jesus was God in the flesh, so you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. There's nothing out of bounds. There's nothing off limits. All things are possible. That is, I'm not sure if it's a direct quote to his omnipotence, but taking the verse very literally, and with God, it's like, well, how far can you take it? Well, he's God, so you can take that pretty far. We're talking about the same Christ who rose from the dead. He died, and he rose himself from the dead. So I think that verse can be taken very, very, very far. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you, be it overcoming sin, be it reaching heaven through his power, be it living for him, be it giving up an old habit, being imbued with power to perform miracles like Jesus did, being granted supernatural health and wealth to, you know, be like this, you know, 110-year-old guy who's, you know, up and running around and driving his car and totally self-sufficient, doesn't need anyone's help. And to be someone who is completely rich, who has millions of dollars and can give tons and tons of money to mission boards and churches and Bible plants, etc., etc., etc. There is nothing off bounds or off limits to those who serve God. I don't think any of that is incorrect to say. Again, I'm not so sure how much that speaks to God's omnipotence, being able to do, like, literally absolutely anything. I personally, and this is just personal opinion, I feel like I have covered those verses exegetically as accurately as possible. And exegetical, exegesis, those are big old churchy, preachy words, which basically means interpreting the Bible correctly. Instead of me trying to pull out some meaning of the scripture that I want it to mean that's convenient for me, that would be eisegesis. I'm trying to pull out of the scripture what it means, what it's trying to say, what the original author, in this case, Paul from the book of Philippians and Matthew from the book of Matthew, what they were trying to say, not trying to make the book mean what I want it to mean, but letting the book mean what it in and of itself means. That's exegesis. So I believe I have exegetically performed my duties on these two passages. I think about Matthew, that's referring more or less to salvation. Philippians is more or less referring to what the believer can do through Christ who strengthens him. It certainly speaks of God's power and what God's capable of doing, and God being able to save a filthy wretch and then equip said filthy wretch to live a holy life and even to have, you know, money where there was no money, and health where there was previously sickness. Those are amazing things. And there are many testimonies in the Old and New Testament of people who were healed, who were given health, horrible, wretched people who obtained forgiveness of their sins. There are plenty of stories on all of those levels, and they're beautiful and wonderful, and all of those things speak to God's power. But if I'm going to refer to a Bible verse that really speaks clearly to God's omnipotence, like just the sheer amount of power that he has, I'm actually going to go to, wait for it, Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And I'm going to pair that up with Hebrews 11:3. Get a little bit of New Testament in there. Hebrews 11:3. By faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which are visible. AKA, there is no universe creating itself. There is no eternity of matter. There was a first cause. Not a causeless effect. I'm confusing my words. I'm very sorry. But there was a first cause. There was a cause that didn't need a cause and effect to create it. It simply always was, and it was not something that was seen or visible, it being God. He created the worlds, not just this world, all the worlds. He created the heavens and the earth. He created all the worlds. And I didn't look up this verse. I kind of wish I had, but there's also a verse, Google is your friend, that says all of creation is held together or sustained by the power of his word. The very fact that our molecules and our cells aren't exploding and bursting into millions of pieces, the fact that the universe is a very contained system, things go in an orderly, logical manner, that is God not only having created everything, but keeping it together and keeping everything in one piece in a continuous, logical, rational, understandable cycle. Now, the inherent problem with this, I am not trying to downplay God's omnipotence. Please understand that. I'm trying to analyze this as accurately and as specifically as I can, because I want to give a good and appropriate answer, not only to the Christians who already believe it, but I also want to give an answer to the non-Christians who will potentially watch this message, who are interested in learning about the Christian God, what we Christians believe. And does any of this make sense at all? It's kind of hard to prove omnipotence. Well, any of the omnis, really. But it's kind of hard to prove omnipotence outside of what we can see. Like, can God do something outside of this creation? Well, I can assume he could, but I really don't know. The only thing that I can tell you is what I see around me and the life that I live and the body that I have and the people that I've met. And of course, people who've looked into the sciences and people who have looked into astronomy, they can testify to a magnificent, splendid, glorious universe outside of this earth that is absolutely mind-bending. Calculations and criteria so precise that it would take a vastly superior mind to anything humans could possibly imagine or dream up to get everything in motion and to get everything in place. It's one of the reasons that I personally don't believe in a big bang outside of a creator. And I also don't personally believe in evolution. For everything to work together as well as it does, it just does not seem feasible to me to say, oh, random chance and luck and a lot of time equal everything that we have. I think there's got to be an orchestrator behind these events. And considering how everything is so finely tuned, a very, very intelligent orchestrator of these events. That's last week or 2 weeks ago when I covered God's omniscience. For some reason, it makes a little bit more sense to me. It clicks a little bit more because so many things are in place. So it's kind of like, yeah, we can nail down that God is he knows everything that exists because he created it all. Whereas omnipotence is kind of like, well, what can he create? there, it's kind of like omniscience. We have an idea of everything that there is. And since he knows everything that there is, he really is all-knowing because he created it all. But when it comes to omnipotence, the question becomes more or less, well, what can he do? What can he create? You know, he knows everything that there is. Could he know something that isn't? And I guess for there, I could refer to prophecies where God said something would happen. It didn't happen because, you know, someone repented and changed their evil ways, or someone good turned to wickedness, and then the blessing did not come to pass the way that God said it. So he saw a future, and God predicted a future that didn't happen because man messed it up. So again, omniscience, a little bit easier, at least for me, to logically and rationally pin down. Omnipotence, where's the upper ceiling? Where are the limits there? We have all of creation, we have the heavens, we have the universe, and we have, of course, the supernatural territories of heaven and hell that the Bible tells us, but we can't measure those. But we know through the Bible and God's word that they exist. So what can God do? Well, we know for certain, all I can say is, you know, and of course, we as humans, we're incredibly limited by what we see. Even with all the modern technology that we have, it's kind of hard to pin down exactly how much there is, because I think, pretty sure that even scientists would say, you know, with all of our learning, all of our technology, and everything that we've learned starting in the 20th century when there was such a boom of information, we as humans collectively know less than 1% of everything that is in existence. There is so much just to this physical universe, much less any spiritual universe that God himself created and dwells in himself. We've only scratched the surface of this physical creation in all of its size and grandeur and wonder. It's absolutely mind-blowing. So even though it's hard to put an upper bound on God's omnipotence, considering what we can see, considering what we do know, and if we have a little bit of faith and can believe what's in the Word of God, he's a big God. One God, not a multitude, not a plethora, one God who's able to create all of this. I'm not just referring to my room. My room is quite glorious. I love my room. Hello, wall. It's good to see you there. I'm glad you're sturdy. I'm glad you don't just fall down in the middle of nowhere. I'm glad you're consistent and you stay. It's great. You help keep noise and intruders and animals out. Sorry, that was a weird, awkward tangent. I'm a weird, awkward person, so that's okay. I say so. My message. I'm allowed to say that. But anyway, all of creation that there is, God, one God, is big enough to do all of that. I think it's safe to say that this God is extremely powerful. Look at black holes, look at suns, things that are cosmic, things that make our entire existence, our entire planet's existence, seem trivial. We can see millions and billions and trillions of somethings that are millions and billions and trillions of times bigger than our collective existence. And all of this is, I believe, a hint at the designer and the master planner and mastermind behind everything. I think it's a glimpse into what God is capable of doing. I don't think that is a limit. I don't think that is the upper bounds, or I don't think God, you know, exhausted himself when he created everything. And I can't point to a specific scripture that says this, but just when I think of what God created, and it says, and the Bible also mentions that just as the heavens are high above the earth, so are God's ways higher than our ways. When I think of this creation, I think to myself, this was God showing us, you know, what he can do. That's not a limit. The universe is small and fleeting in comparison to its creator. A verse that talks about that is going to be in Revelation. And I know Revelation is highly symbolic in what it says. I'm very well aware of that. But I think even the symbolism itself can speak kind of strongly as to who God is. Now, if I can find this particular verse, I'll be in good shape. Here we go. It's Revelation chapter 20, verse 11. Didn't prepare this one, but it came to my mind. Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was no and there was found no place for them. The earth and the heaven, everything that exists, fled away from God because there was found no place for them. God is so big, this universe doesn't have room for him. And Solomon talks about in one of his prayers that the heaven of heavens cannot contain his presence. More on that in a future message. So God, and I'll say it, all three of the omnis kind of bounce back and forth between each other. His omnipresence kind of gives us an idea, a little bit of who he is. And because of how big he is, that gives me, a basis on which to say how powerful he is. That the whole universe can't find room to contain his presence. If God's that big, then I really do think that everything that is created is a small glimpse of, if there is some upper bound in his power, it's a small glimpse on what that power of his is. Whew, God is big, guys. God, there's no comparison. There is nothing really to compare God to within this creation. He's so much bigger and so much stronger and so much smarter than anything that we could possibly measure it by. And because God is so far out of our bounds, I mean, we get glimpses. Like, this universe is a glimpse of his power. This Bible is a glimpse into his mind, into his morality. And the fact that his presence is everywhere gives us a glimpse into how big he, as a being, is. We can't grasp all of him. And in that sense, he's beyond our comprehension. But we get the small glimpses. We get the small pieces of who he is. And thus we recognize that he's real. He's powerful. He's smart. And his presence covers a really wide radius and area. God is huge, vastly beyond any human mind's ability to comprehend. And along those lines, it was like, yeah, as usual, I didn't get to nearly all of my points and not nearly everything that I wanted to do and everything that I wanted to say, but I think I'm going to end with this classic thing that a lot of people like to ask. If God's all-powerful, can he create a rock that he can't lift? I would like to answer that question with a yes and with a no. And no, I'm not, and I'm not trying to pull something out of my rear, and I'm not trying to bait and switch you. I'm being dead serious, and I'm going to elaborate on the yes and the no. One, can God create a rock that's so big that he can't lift it? And then the argument would be, well, you know, if yes, he can, then he's not all-powerful. And if he can't, if he can create a rock that he can't lift, then that rock exceeds him and he's not all-powerful. And if he can't, well, he can't create it. Therefore, he's not all-powerful, so there's no way he can be all-powerful. To me, that's silly and, quite frankly, stupid. The definition of all-powerful is without limitation. Within the very definition of the word, all limitations are removed. There are no limitations. So if God is truly all-powerful, obviously he cannot create a rock so big that he can't lift it. There's nothing beyond him. He can never create a rock so big that he can't lift it. There's nothing outside of his bounds because he is all-powerful. I guess in comparison to that, to say, you know, kind of like because of God's nature of who he is, and God's word also backs it up in Numbers 23:19. Since God is a God of truth, there's another limitation, quote unquote, he can't lie. So let's read Numbers 23:19. Numbers 23:19, God is not a man that he should lie, nor son of man that he should repent. Has he said, and will he not do? Or has he spoken, and will he not make it good? If God says it, it's going to come to pass. Now, when he speaks, like I covered earlier, within certain metrics, that word is bound. So when he promises a blessing, that's contingent upon our obedience. If he promises a curse, that's contingent upon our disobedience. If our paths change, God will change his decision to honor at what we have done. You know, he'd rather not curse. He'd rather bless, if at all possible. And thus his mercy and continuous chances to repent. And sometimes sinners having long lives because God keeps extending his arm open out to them again and again and again and again because he wants them to repent and he wants to give them another chance and he wants them to see him giving them another chance. He knows he's giving them another chance, but he wants the human to get, hey, dude, you're getting another chance. So God can't lie. He can't betray his own word. And just as he's limited morally, he cannot lie. Just so he is limited in he's limited in his powerfulness. There's never a way in which he can be powerless. Now, the yes answer to that comes in where if God is God and he is all powerful, what is to say he's bound by our rules of logic? It does work in this universe, but according to the Bible, there is a universe outside of our own, heaven and hell. There's a spiritual domain. And quite frankly, who knows what else God has created? There's no telling. We don't know. We can't see it. We can't perceive it. And if God did create it, couldn't he create something outside of our comprehension? We can't comprehend him. Couldn't he create something smaller than him but bigger than us? Theoretically, of course that's possible. And if logic is thrown out the window, you could wrap this around and say, since God is all powerful, yes, he could create a boulder that is too big for him to lift. But then at the exact same time, because, you know, forget logic, God will turn around and pick it up anyway. Because who needs logic when you're God? Well, he knows how to use it. We have a world and a system here that work pretty consistently and pretty well. So God obviously knows what logic and rationale are. And we have systems by which to measure things here in the physical universe. So there's the yes and the no answer. And in a more interesting kind of a twist, God is so powerful that he can limit himself. When he became the Son of Man, Jesus, a lot of scholars debate and theologians debate, you know, how was Jesus limited? What were his limitations when he became a human being? And that can be argued for quite a while. But it does say in Philippians 2, 5 through 11, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And if Jesus was limited, as I personally believe, in his omnipotence, omniscience, and omnipresence while he was down here, I believe that Jesus was fully dependent on the Father and the Holy Spirit living within him while he was down here. And that while Jesus was down here, at least prior to the resurrection, he gave up his omni attributes. There were plenty of boulders that Jesus the human could not lift at that time. So God, again, the incarnation has also been referred to as a mystery in the New Testament by Paul, and I think rightly so. The all-powerful God, he limited himself. He stepped out of his super amazing bigness and became a human being like us to die on the cross for our sins and rise again from the dead, guaranteeing us eternal life. So, he's so powerful, he made himself not all powerful for a time. And he did it for us. He did it for you. He did it for me. Won't you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior right now? That all-powerful God who reigns from heaven is extending his arm to you right now and saying, come son, come daughter, come and follow me. And all you gotta do is tell him you believe, Tell him you believe that he died for you and that he rose again 3 days later, and you will be saved. And if you want a prayer to follow kind of as an example or a model, pray this prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus, I admit that I'm a sinner. I believe that you died on the cross and rose again 3 days later. I believe you hear this prayer right now, and I'm asking you, Jesus, to save me and make me your child. Thank you, God, for hearing this prayer. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. And if you prayed that prayer, you are a child of God, you are forgiven, and the all-powerful God has saved you, made you his own, and will take you unto himself one day when you pass out of this life and pass into the next. So that is awesome. Congratulations to you for those of you who accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. If I could encourage you real quick before I go, read just a little bit of this every day. Pray just a little bit to him every day. That'll get you in touch with your Heavenly Father. It'll get you to know through his word what he thinks, how he feels, a little bit more about who he is, and find a group of people, a church, with like-minded beliefs that Jesus is God, that the Bible's the word of God. And on the prayer real quick, prayer doesn't have to be 1 hour, 30 minutes, or something long. A simple, God, thanks for the day, or God, help, today sucks. Those are valid prayers. God hears those. And the all-powerful God will give you an all-powerful answer. It may not be what you're expecting, but he hears his children who cry out to him. Guys, thank you very much for watching this video. I love you, and God bless.